Gospel according to Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. A voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. As I already mentioned, today is the first Sunday in 2018, which began less than a week ago. And it's the first Sunday in the season of Epiphany, which began yesterday. The readings this morning are also about beginnings. In our Old Testament reading from Genesis, we have the beginning of the Bible, the beginning of creation, and the beginning of the story of God and God's people. In our second lesson from Acts, we hear about the beginning of the church at Ephesus, as well as the beginning for a group of people who will become followers of Jesus, where they'd previously been disciples of John. And in our gospel, we hear about the beginning of Jesus' earthly ministry, which starts with his baptism. Unlike Matthew and Luke, who start their gospels with narratives of Jesus' birth, Mark's gospel begins with Jesus' baptism, which is when Jesus' ministry would begin. Mark's gospel is the shortest of all the gospel, and so he wastes no time in getting right to the point. Jesus is the beloved Son of God. There are some other similarities in our readings today. They all deal with water. In the Old Testament, it is the face of the waters over which God's wind or spirit moves. And in both the second lesson and gospel lesson, we have baptisms, which also involve water. In ancient cultures, water is often represents chaos. Water moves where it will. It can cause flooding and destruction, as we've seen this past year in Texas, Florida, and Puerto Rico. Water can slam boats into rocks. It can cut new channels in the ground. In the form of heavy snow and ice, it can collapse roofs. Water is powerful and unpredictable. In Genesis, when God's Spirit moves over the waters, it is the beginning of God creating order out of chaos. Light and dark are separated. Sea and air are separated. Dry land appears. The sun, moon, and stars are created to order time. Plants and animals are created, each of their own kind. And ultimately, humans are created to care for creation. Instead of some formless void in the darkness, which is another representation of chaos and the unknown, there is life and light and order. And baptism, like those we read about this morning, is a lot like that as well. In baptism, each of us become children of God and receive God's Holy Spirit. With those two gifts, the darkness that is our sinful nature and the chaos that is our sinful life becomes lightened and ordered. Now that doesn't mean there won't still be times when things seem, or perhaps even are, chaotic or bleak. Yet even in those times, we have a lifeline to God in the form of the Holy Spirit. And despite the characterization of the Holy Spirit as a dove, the Holy Spirit is neither gentle nor tame. When the Spirit descends like a dove in our gospel reading, it is out of heavens that have been torn apart. This is not some ethereal opening of heavens to shine down on the beloved Son. The heavens are torn open, ripped apart by this event that has just occurred, the baptism of Jesus and the beginning of his ministry here on earth. Things would never be the same again. Even if we had read just a few verses further in Mark's gospel this morning, we would learn that that same Spirit drove Jesus into the wilderness where he would be tempted by Satan. No, the Holy Spirit is neither gentle nor tame. And being filled with the Spirit in baptism is no guarantee of a peaceful order of life. Yet in the Spirit granted to us at baptism, there is a strength on which we can lean. Martin Luther would say that when he was troubled by doubts, he would say, "I am baptized." He didn't rely on himself. He didn't rely on his own abilities. He relied on his baptism. He relied on God. For baptism is not something we do, though we are witnesses to it and participants in it. Rather, baptism is something done to us by God. It is the manifestation of God's claim on us. And that claim is as powerful as the chaotic oceans that were calmed in the creation narrative. That claim is as powerful as the forces that tore the heavens apart in our gospel lesson. Both of those forces are but glimpses of God's power and his work in this world, ordering chaos, the world's and ours, and boldly breaking into our mundane existence to bring us light and life. And so God says to you and to all who are baptized, just as he said to Jesus this day so long ago, "You are my beloved child. In you I am well pleased." I invite you to stand as you are able for our hymn of the day, number 305. This is not a real familiar one, so Ellen is going to play the whole.